So the lecture is about the vast number of things that we think about now in architecture of buildings and communities, much different from when I started my career 30 plus years ago. We had a fairly conventional education. The building was systems internally and a skin and a look and technology to support that. I think you'll be astonished at the number of subjects I cover in the next 50 minutes. And so the idea is to convey to you that as architects, you and others in the profession, we have an enormous breadth of impact on society. We architects do much more than build. We must include, obviously, form and functional considerations, envelope and environmental issues, social issues. We must invest in our work, innovate in our work. We must have passion for doing more than just project building. We must care deeply about what we design and what we are capable of being, of doing, and of changing. We must think about systems that are affected, public spaces, community needs, the watershed, the biosphere. All things in nature are connected. I began my practice in 1984, so it's been 31 years. I began experimenting with new approaches and innovations immediately. I actually built this place by hand, myself, as a one-person practice. I raised questions about my priorities and established new priorities. I placed the office on the street in one of the most dangerous parts of Vancouver, equivalent to the Tenderloin, I guess. I wanted to confront society with design. So it comes right from the beginning. I then went on to form a business association and other organizations in that part of town that changed that area dramatically and permanently. So I was politicized. Take that. So I was interested in the political aspects that led to my social interests in architecture right from year one. I have many people that affected me, many to thank in my early part of my career. I did manage to, as a young architect, get a place in Norman Foster's office when it was just 26 people. We were visited by many people, including a project with Buckminster Fuller, shown in this image here. This is a 1979 rendering of something called Climatrophis, which explored Bucky's theories of stratification and the dynamics of air movement in interconnected spaces. It also shows plants and flexible workspaces, interconnected daylit spaces. So even from then, I was affected by these ideas that are still part of my architecture. In the 1979, I entered a competition sponsored by the Sunday Times in London called The House for the 80s. This is an image from that competition. And you can see, this is 1979. You can see radiant concrete floor systems with liquid tubing. You can see photovoltaics, natural ventilation, cross ventilation, wind power. We understood already the cycles of the season and of the day in how buildings would perform. This is a very long time ago, and I say it really to tell you that that the ideas that we're going to talk about today had their germination in those times. I've always been interested in more than just designing space, building it. This is a 1986 project after I started my own practice of a series of shop interiors made in one location and packaged into containers and delivered to different cities across Canada for the purposes of fitting out retail space. And it's fitted with castings and extrusions and fabrications that I designed. Every single thing in this room I designed and built and made. So this idea that we design things and understand how they're made and how to make them and how to shape the parts has its origins in at this time, but obviously when you think about sustainability, those passions and those interests are even more pressing. We need to know the polluting effects of where the castings are and how they're made and the recycling effects of them. So even from the early days, these things mattered. Here's an early building, also 1986, a city hall, and in this building there are laser cut and water jet cut components made directly from the computer files. So another aspect of innovation and how we get connected to industry is that has grown from the beginning is this interest in manufacturing and the relationship between our computer capability and what we build. Obviously, growing up as you know, in the era when we went to the moon, we were fascinated with technology. We believed that technology could solve all evils, and so the space race and the Foster Office and all of these kinds of things really gave me one side of what I'm interested in. But since then, I've learned the hard way that technology can do a lot of wrong. And I look up to this is an image from Hayoguai, which is some islands off the coast in British Columbia, where the natives lived in harmony, and as some of the most prolific artists of any native or native group in North America, because of the abundance of food. They simply didn't have to go hunting the clams, the mussels, the oysters, the salmon, everything was there for the picking. This shows the intertidal complexity of that landscape in all its beauty. So listening to David Suzuki talk about our responsibilities, which he started as a scientist, in terms of the biosphere and the globe, and Paul Hawken also, who wrote the introduction to this book, Dr. Ray Cole at the University of British Columbia, I've had a 35-year relationship with, taught me another way of seeing and thinking about our responsibilities toward nature and where we sit. I was also inspired by Suzuki's tireless political efforts and lecturing. He's over 75 and continues to donate pretty well 100% of his time to convince others about the right things to do. And I don't spend anywhere near that percent of my time, but I do lecture constantly, and I do try to bring these themes of our responsibility as architects and designers in relation to the biosphere and global warming to everyone I meet. So technology balanced with nature is the learning. I'll begin with social responsibility. I have kind of five or six themes here. The first one is social responsibility. Architecture is the only art that's in the public. You know, if you paint paintings, you can hide them or you can keep them somewhere. If you dance or if you sing, the public can take it or leave it. Architecture is a social contract. We build in the public space. We have obligations to contribute to our communities, to contribute to urbanism, contribute to healthy and productive lives of the people who work inside our buildings and live inside our buildings. And we have a responsibility to contribute to nature. Perkins Will obviously has a long history of social responsibility. In the 30s and 40s, it became famous for reinventing how education was practiced, starting with this Crow Island School, Perkins and Will and the Saarinen brothers in 1930. A more recent project, we've designed Princess Nur University in Riyadh. This is the first university for women in Saudi, and it opened to 40,000 women on day one. So nothing will do more to change the society of Saudi Arabia than education of the women. And that's a social commitment, a social responsibility, and something we find in our work. We are what we specify, and we have a responsibility to do research and to understand what we do and do no harm. This is an image taken from Progressive Architecture in 1955, indicating that asbestos is the new penicillin of the construction world, if you can imagine that perspective. Of course, we learned that it wasn't. It was, in fact, a poison and has killed thousands and cost billions of dollars to remove. So we have a responsibility to understand, to read healthy product declarations, to study up on what we use and how we use it in society. Architecture, the social aspects of architecture also touch politics. Buildings can be powerful symbols of government, whether repressive, progressive, or democratic. They can represent social content and political content, and they can unite countries, they can unite people around the world. So the social content of architecture can be extremely powerful. These are diagrams from grade 3 and grade 4 children at an elementary school that I designed, where we had a workshop with them at the beginning of the design process. And the school was a fairly institutional gray brick masonry, devoid of anything. And what you'll notice here is that they're asking for gardens. They're asking for daylight. They're asking for unusual shapes. They're asking to be freed of the institutional power of architecture, to be connected with their surroundings, to be connected with each other, to be connected with nature. This evokes this connection that we have as designers of school, not to be perhaps, of all spaces, not to be perhaps the most efficient or the most cost-effective, but to listen and carry in these other ideas that extend architecture beyond what it is in plan. And this is, in fact, the school that they got. And of course, it's 100% daylit, it's made out of wood, it's got interesting shapes, the roof has PVs on it, the mechanical space is at ground level and has glass in it so they can understand what they do. There are gardens outside to learn in science class how to grow plants and food. There's a wetland as part of the landscape, so the science classes can happen out there. We integrated nature and irregularity, if you will, into the project. This is a pro bono project. The Tenderloin Museum, it just opened. So we as architects and Perkins and Will, we donate 1% of our total time across the firm to do free work for our communities. And the Tenderloin Museum is our most recent project completed. This may not have happened if we hadn't been able to infuse them with our organizational skills, our design skills, to get this project up and running and built. So we can give directly back in our social responsibility. Corporate social responsibility is something that you're probably not thinking too much about at the moment, but one day you work for yourself or for a mid-sized firm or for a larger firm, and you will think, okay, so what's my architecture about? Are we just making money, or is the business side of it something that we can make progress in? So at Perkins and Will, we have a number of things that are that connect us as an organization with responsibility, and we call it our social responsibility commitments. We started with Sustainable Design Initiative in 2007. This happens to be the one from 2007. We wrote our first one in 2004 when I joined the firm. We've updated them every few years. This is about internal education, about research, about operations, how we run our businesses, how green, how much our carbon footprint is, how much water we use, how much all of those things. But it's also about spreading sustainable design through our firm so that most of or all of the projects have one level of sustainable design or another, as we feel it's the right thing to do. We had at one point, and still do, over 1,000 LEED APs in our organization. So that's a professional certification of sustainable design knowledge that's as part of the USGBC's. But we also do research. We have 14 researchers on staff. We publish something called a precautionary list along this theme of going back to the penicillin of the industry. We do research with scientists principally at Yale University on the origin of materials, the toxicity of materials, and their health impacts. So you can go on our website and you can see our precautionary list, a list of 38 products today, that, or 38 chemicals and products that we don't want to find in our buildings, that we commit not to put into our buildings because of the health impacts that are there. And this list is available to anybody, and it's published and distributed regularly and spoken upon regularly. Our offices have, over the 11 years that I've been involved, and before that too, become most sustainable places to work, healthy places to work. This happens to be my Vancouver office, where I was the managing director until 3 years ago when I came down here. It's an old candy factory, and we cut holes in it for daylighting and natural ventilation, stratification. It's healthy materials throughout. It's naturally ventilated and daylit. So this is our record as a company about our total potable water use over the last 10 years, despite the fact that during that period, our firm has grown over 70% in size. So we're at 1,900 people now. We were at 1,200 at the beginning of that. So we're changing out the fixtures. We're teaching water conservation in our firm. This is our energy use in our premises. And again, it's coming down year over year, even though, again, 10 years ago we had 16 offices. Today we have 27. So we're practicing what we preach. Ed Mazzaria started the 2030 Challenge about 10 years ago. It's about the carbon footprint of what we design. Ed is convinced and has convinced others that carbon is the climate change issue. And as builders of buildings that have carbon in them and consume carbon in operations, he convinced many organizations, including the AIA in the US and the RIAC in Canada, as well as many engineering associations, to commit to the 2030 Challenge, which means that you will follow a series of steadily descending goals in terms of reduction of carbon consumption in the buildings. He started at like 50% reduction. Today we're at 70%, and by 2030 the idea is that all architects and engineers designing buildings would not consume carbon. Well, we know how to do this. I'm going to show you zero carbon, zero energy buildings today. So we don't have to wait to 2030. It's hard to convince all clients to go there, but it is certainly possible. And so this is our carbon footprint as a firm. Again, growing, 30% reduction over the 10 years. Again, that's against massively increased numbers of projects and turnover in the firm. We're committed. We were the first large firm to commit to the 2030 Challenge, and we're steadily reducing carbon content in our buildings. Designing green buildings leads us to a new era of accountability. This is a University of British Columbia study comparing the behavior of people in two different buildings. The building on the right, the CSRS building, I'm going to show you, the Center for Interactive Research on Sustainability. It's a very green building. And the sub-building, the Student Union building on the left, is a more normal building. It's not green. Same demographics using the same buildings, the same students. And you can see that proper waste disposal, 60% of the students in the sub-building put the garbage in the right containers, but over 80% in CSRS do. So they're the same kids, but they're behaving better in this deep green building. they rate themselves differently. A certain percent of the students in the sub building would call themselves environmentalists, but the CSRS building, it's a significantly higher number. So this is a behavioral change. This means that our architecture, it goes back to responsibility, our architecture is able to teach people to be environmentalists, to behave environmentally responsibly, simply by the way it's designed and the values and systems in it and what they represent. So we can affect an extremely wide variety of things with the responsibility that we show, both as individuals and as designers and as a company. Changing the subject again, I want to talk about innovation. And I believe that architects to be successful today have to engender a culture of innovation in their practices and in what they do. And I believe that from the very beginning, and I believe it even more so now, particularly coming down to the Bay Area, where, the home of so much innovation, mostly in computer systems and so on, but in your life as architects or designers, you can innovate constantly as well. I'm going to cover three different areas of innovation. Physical innovations, that's like structural and modular approaches and industrial design and use of materials. And then ideas as areas in which we can innovate. And of course, sustainable design is one idea area that where we can innovate. This is by no means comprehensive. I'm just pulling examples along with dates we'll start with structural innovation. So this is EBCO Aerospace in 1987 with a suspended structure. This is Brentwood SkyTrain station with a hybrid steel and wood structure and an interesting kind of seismic solution. This is DIFC, Dubai Financial District, with an enormous Verandiel truss that reduced the two buildings, reduced the amount of rebar by about 20%. So I've been interested in structural innovation as what we do. And as an architect, I know quite a bit about structure and how things are made as a result of this interest. I've been interested in modular approaches to things. I guess I got that from Norman. This was that modular components in that iMaster store I showed you, dating from 1992. This is a more recent 2012 transit station where you can see prefabricated modular panels that were literally craned into the site, complete with membranes and waterproofing and structural reinforcing and signage and electricity. So we continue to pursue that approach. I've been interested in industrial design since the beginning. This is actually my very first built project as an architect after I opened my own business. It's a coffee kiosk, street food, street furniture, designed around in partnership with the Paraplegic Association of British Columbia at the time. So the entire operation of this coffee serving and cleaning is within the capabilities of a person in a wheelchair. These are the refrigeration and water tanks. He or she can reach out to change the condiments and serve, as well as lifting in and out with a wheelchair lift. Designed this using innovations in, this is a fiberglass molds made by the boat building industry. These are compound acrylic curves made in vacuum form molds. These are automotive pistons from the hatchback of a Pinto, if you're old enough to know what that is. So it's there's a lot of cool kind of innovations in it. I've always designed furniture. This is a table we call a giraffe. So this is a wood, machined wood fabrication. and details of it. Enjoy how things go together. I taught industrial design for 4 years, nearly part of my career. We made a series of light fixtures, some of which are in production today. This is one called a Gill. We designed a series of furniture or of telephones for a company that doesn't exist anymore, Nortel. I had my own industrial design firm called Design Lines from 1987 to 2004 when I just became too busy to tend to it. We made objects, we made castings and extrusions under a company named called Components, which still exists, and I don't own it anymore. But it makes all of these parts that that make our architecture interesting. We did it as part of our design process, but then we spun off a company. I think these two images also show how industrial design has affected my design. You know, if you understand structure and you understand industrial design, you understand how to put these pieces together, and so we can make much more beautiful final solutions this way. And I encourage you, all of you, to think about those things. Innovation in the use of materials. This is a building completed in 1999, made out of 80% recycled material. So the structure, our trusses taken from an industrial building and reused. The glazing is a wood curtain wall, hand built out of recycled wood. Of course, all the cladding is recycled. The mechanical systems were salvaged from demolition yards, the toilets, so much of 80% of the materials in this building. We wanted to push the envelope. This happens to be a lab for the engineering department of the city of Vancouver. The engineering department of the city of Vancouver collects the garbage. So we went into their yards and said, look, we'll build a building out of this for you. Now, we don't do that in every building, but we do certainly include salvaged materials in all our buildings. This is a building recently completed with a company called Dialogue in Alberta, in Quebec, in Calgary. And the unique aspects of this, I guess, are many. But this part's about materials. This is superform aluminum that when we were designing this, the car industry in North America failed. You know, in 2007, it was a disaster. So we realized there were a lot of tools and dies and people who made door panels and so on not doing anything. So we got a super deal on these panels from the automobile industry. And of course, they can be shaped any way you wish. And all four different elevations have different shapings in the way they reflect and direct light. I'll tell you about only one. This is the south face of the building. They're very large buildings over here. The sun is very low in the wintertime. So we designed these panels to be high at the top and to reflect sunlight down and onto the paving and the entrance of the building, creating even in the dead of winter, when all of the ground would otherwise be in shade, there are pools of daylight here. And of course, the operable, this is the first time I've ever had an operable skin made by Schuko, the ability to close insulated panels on spaces, interconnected spaces at night to protect the heat. I've always been interested in wood as an original building system. Of course, today I try to use as much as possible. It's very difficult in California to use wood. There are so many rules saying we can't. But in other jurisdictions in particular, where most of my built work is done in North America, north of the border, wood is, of course, the only building material made by the sun. It is 2/3 carbon by weight. So it's a carbon sink. We've designed buildings that have more carbon in them due to the wood than all of the other materials in the building contain. So all of the carpet and aluminum and all the other things, the manufacturer emits carbon, but in wood we can sequester carbon. So I have actually built a building that's carbon neutral in its fabric, not just in its operations. But anyway, this all started out with a building we designed in 1989. This is a wood manufacturing facility, and these are Paralam members that are 60 feet long. That's what they make and ship. So we made this stair out of Paralam elements. This is that city hall I showed you, dating from the mid-90s, composite scarfed king posts, steel and wood, very, very beautiful combination. This is a lab that was finished in 2012 at University of British Columbia, instead of the high performance lab, instead of the typical steel or concrete construction. This is laminated and diaphragms made out of wood and with the performance proven to be as vibration free as those other materials. This is that school again with laminated prefabricated panels acting as diaphragms and structure. This is actually 2x3s only. That is the roof. So imagine enormous conservation of material, the graceful beauty of that king post solution, and the economy of materials in it. You have to keep committed to these things. This is another recent project where a very beautiful wood and steel joint, steel connectors, forms the main element of the project. So those are physical innovations. Now we can talk about innovations in ideas. And of course, sustainable design is an idea, and it results in physical solutions. It started with a project in 1992, heavily influenced by Ian McCarg and Design with Nature. I read that book, and I can still quote you. I read it at school, actually, and in university, and I can still quote you the main tenets of that the idea of designing developments that would respect areas of nature, that would be integrated in nature, the idea of valuing where the impact of what you are doing would least affect nature, would least disrupt water courses, would least disrupt the path of migrating fauna, would preserve the most beautiful parts of the flora. So this was a development in which the developer was proposing a kind of a suburban development, and we developed this design for them and showed them that they could actually preserve 77% of the natural topography and vegetation if they designed it according to the principles of Design with Nature. And Ian McCarg, this is my first displacement ventilation building, finished in 1995, underfloor air, naturally ventilated. These are shading structures on the southeast and west. There are also light shelves inside. An ultra high performance building. In those days, before LEED, we were interested in energy performance as of sustainability pretty well exclusively. We hadn't learned. LEED taught us to look at these other things, sight and views and other types of performance. But the environmental movement started with the oil crisis and energy systems. Here's the first LEED Gold building in Canada, designed with recycle. It's designed on an old sewage treatment plant. These are the old treatment tubs. This is now filled with storm water. There's a heat sink inside, so it's both with the heat pumps. It's both heating and cooling for the building, all the native species of plants that were around. This is composted solids from the sewage treatment plant. There are solar hot water tubes and PVs in this building. It met a lot of new things in the criteria that we learned from LEED. Here's a student center in Dallas, Texas, completed a few years ago with the shading structures. This was a project with Peter Walker as the landscape architect, an incredible person to work with. And if you go to Dallas sometime, you got to see these four-sided glass buildings everywhere. I mean, it's just ridiculous in that kind of a climate. These are I show you that DIFC project, tall project. These are Verandio trusses go through here, but this is designed oriented towards the prevailing wind, and the narrowing of this space accelerates the wind from 5 knots, 5 times more energy in the space here than the actual air passing by the building, generating about 20% of the total energy in the building. I've been interested in envelopes, obviously, as a sustainable design. This is an early building, again, 1994, Earth Sciences building at University of Toronto. Of course, shading elements, well studied, four different elevations, four different finish, four different treatments. This happens to be a climate that gets cold in the wintertime, so this is the main lecture hall. These are insulated shutters that open and close as per temperature and need for daylight. And this is a building just completed 2 years ago at University of Washington, the Husky Union building, where the insulated shutters that open and close by day and night are now also have acoustic functions and are made more beautifully out of wood. So there are themes. I'm trying to illustrate these ideas are thematic and they cover a period of time. In the course of all of the early work in sustainable design, we had to explore and understand how natural systems work. So CFD modeling became useful. We understood ground effect of natural cooling, earth tubes, and so on. So we could, in summer, the building performs a certain way. In the winter, it performs another way. Passive solar gain, extracting energy. And keeping it in the building in the spring and the fall, it's a wide open building. So we learned that buildings were organic entities that had daily cycles, monthly cycles, and yearly cycle, annual cycles, and we learned how to manipulate them in the way we designed shapes, spaces, we oriented spaces, did displacement ventilation into atriums, underfloor, in lecture halls. Something that today we call whole systems thinking, and that's a sustainable design idea. This is a section of CSIRS, the Center for Interactive Research on Sustainability at UBC, which is built, and these are the whole systems that are in that building. So we have rainwater collection and storage in a cistern, and treatment and recharge to a cistern. We have solar aquatics, black water treatment, and use of that added to gray water in the toilets. We have our energy systems, heat exchanger, ground source, transfer from an adjacent building, and these ideas can go quite a way, and they can also be. As sustainable designers, we think about sustainable design of communities now. So that's an urbanist approach. This happens to be a project in Abu Dhabi, where we were retained to look at how we could reduce the city is due to grow by about 1 million people over a short period of time. How to design the growth of that city, and of course. They had a classic downtown of offices, and then everybody got in a car and went out to the suburbs and lived in their villas, and they didn't really have a sense of urbanistic ideas. So we developed mixed-use strategies for downtown. We developed a new secondary node for mixed-use and a new capital, actually. We developed transit systems, four levels of transit, high-speed rail, down to a surface streetcar. Type solutions. We eliminated the planned construction of a superhighway system that would have made LA look parochial. We introduced environmental ideas into the conversation with the leaders of these communities. As a result, they established environmental laws for the community. They'd never had them before. They established public parks. These are wetland marine parks where they're endangered mangoes and fish and wildlife and habitat at the edge of the Red Sea. They even set aside desert parks as a result of us. So we had this enormous impact on not just the design of the city, but the lives of the people and the impacts of the government indeed as well. The next kind of innovation idea is tied up with it's entitled The Exploration of Form, and it's tied up with computers. When we started AutoCAD version 1.4, it was pretty simple. You made squares and you made lines, and your buildings look kind of square and kind of made like they looked. Recently, with the advent of Rhino and Grasshopper and all of these other wonderful tools, we can do so much more as architects. And so this is a bit of a tracing about, this is a building built in 2001, compound curves and a shape. There's a transit station that becomes quite seductive as a result of the software. This is a series of transit stations in Ottawa, designed with computational design. So these are modular panels, and using a computational design, principally Grasshopper, we were able to create environmental constraints about what panels went where, and then the shaping of those panels, and then the manufacturing of those panels as a result of this interconnection between software and design capabilities. These are things that are unheard of earlier. This is a building that's featured in this is the Van Dusen Botanical Gardens, principally designed in Rhino. Principally, it's a botanical garden, so there's a kind of a floral theme. This happens to be modeled after a native orchid that grows in the forests of British Columbia, and we took some of these leaves and abstracted them. But it also It's also a natural ventilation system, this oculus that is heated up by the sun and drives ventilation under these panels and into the center of the building. Another idea that's changed over the years is the idea of consultation and engagement of the public and stakeholders. This links back to our social responsibility, but it's quite a change. 30 years ago, the very wealthy banker or whatever hired the firm with the greatest prowess in technical delivery to deliver tall banks and other buildings that you can see, obviously, in the downtowns of most of the world. The public really didn't have a say. The zoning codes at the time were minuscule. The requirement to engage the public, not so much. Today, we spend probably, as if I looked at all the hours spent by our office in San Francisco, involved in either preparing for or submitting or engaging with a public engagement, it would probably be in excess of 20 or 30%. So a lot of our effort is to understand what other people want of architecture and architects and our built solution. These are those kids at that elementary school learning that their ideas, being told that their ideas could affect the school that they're coming, and look at the impact it has on them. It's profoundly empowering. Of course, it empowers all manner of community groups, but it is an exciting part of what we have to do as architects now that we never had to do before. Continuous education. We have a responsibility to both learn and teach others. This happens to be an exhibit that we designed and built. It was shown in 2004 at Greenbelt, and it is an exhibit that's fully modular, as you imagine, and demountable, all those things. But it features all of the state-of-the-art sustainability components that you could design into an apartment or a condo. So we called it the Sustainable Condo Exhibit. And it really it was built to entice developers to build these things into their projects, but also to attract customers who to demand these things. If they could see what a dual flush toilet was, or what all of the kind of it had LED lighting in it in 2004. That's out there, and it was very successful. It exhibited for about 5 years in different locations, and was seen by over 250,000 people. So we educate others, and we think about it all the time. This is Cities in a Climate of Change. We put together we combed all the websites of the cities in North America looking for best practices in sustainable design. Now, of course, cities are where it's at. They collect the garbage, they provide the water, they have the park space, they set the building codes, they regulate construction activity, and they're responsible for the healthiness of our cities, the air and the pollution and so on. So we took the best policies available at that time, and then we visited, this was a Canadian effort, there are 25 major cities in Canada. We visited 20 of the 25 cities with this book in hand, met with the mayor and council and the planners and so on, and said, here, this is best practices, everything green, combed from North America, and why don't you implement it in your community? And to a certain extent, it was extremely successful. You might be interested to know that some of the best practices were from San Francisco. New York was also very progressive, but of course, Portland was out there, and Seattle was pretty good too. So I've always believed that our offices should be an innovation test bed. So this is my first office on Granville Street that I built myself. It has four seats. This is a second one where we got into distributed mechanical systems and natural ventilation and shading on the exterior of the building. The ability to open up the building inside and out, the first kind of courtyard. There are courtyards in most of my buildings now, so that nature penetrates deep into the building. This is my current Vancouver office with recycled rubber tires on the floor, natural ventilation throughout, a big atrium that drives it, almost no energy consumption whatsoever as we capture through a heat exchanger the heat from the lighting and the folks who work there and feed it back. This another detail, this is ductile, a new type of concrete that is very thin and very strong. We put in this living wall to refresh and moisturize the water. That I noticed the other day has some funny plants growing in it, so we'll have to talk more about that, I guess, with somebody. Anyway, this is my San Francisco office. There's no drywall in this office. It's a completely modular, prefabricated office, and it has an astonishing opportunity to have 100% daylit space, as that we're innovating in column. We build all these skylights, and we're columnating the sunshine with mini heliostats, and then reflecting that light out on the ceilings. We're on our third prototype of this. We don't have it right yet, but even the idea of hanging prototypes in the office where all the folks who work for us can see them and can see that we're experimenting, we're trying to achieve something, this idea of continuous innovation. Fostering a design culture, this is extremely important. Again, going back, artists were kind of architects. They sat in a garret somewhere and they sketched, and they gave the sketch to a draftsman and an engineer. They said, make it stand up, you make it warm, and you make it safe. We don't do that anymore. We use design charrettes. We have everybody at the table talking about, so that's the landscape architect, the mechanical engineer, the structural engineer, the client. The whole team sits at the table. And we actually had a great charrette today, so I'm still pumped from that. And we exchange ideas, and we critique each other's work. We have peer reviews where we bring in people from around the firm to look at, notable practitioners like Ralph Johnson. Of course, this is Kathy Simon, that some of you know, to crit our work and to make sure that it's the best possible. We want this to be seen within the office by the younger folks that are there. We want them to understand that design is a process that involves the best ideas and the best minds, not the dictations of one person or another. Whole systems thinking is another thing that's emerged from both these considerations and our understanding of sustainable design. The first project where we looked at it was Dockside Green. Which was the first phase, was completed in 2005. It's zero net energy and zero net carbon, so it meets the 2030 challenge today. There are 28 buildings around a district energy loop. That's where energy is moved from building to building with a water loop, so that the retail components that are creating energy can waste heat can heat the residential units. The offices that are generating energy at other times, can heat can be moved. There's industrial plants, industrial loft spaces here. There's a natural or an artificial stream down the center of this that created by our landscape architects, which is the place where stormwater is detained, stored, and filtered and cleaned by a landscape before it enters the ocean. It's also a beautiful feature. And these are, this is the biomass cogen plant or biomass heating plant, a district energy plant, where we're taking waste wood from the forestry industry. And this is our first whole systems diagram. So what is it? It's a district energy system. We're taking waste, we're gasifying it, we're putting in a boiler, and we're running a district energy loop to the various buildings and connecting them to allow them to share this energy. We're also we're also treating our own sewage on site, and we're taking methane off of that and putting it into the gasifier to add it. The waste products from that are water, and we sold the water to an adjacent factory that uses it. We also put it in the toilets in the project, and we have composting going on that includes the fly ash, or so the ash and sludge from the water treatment, as well as kitchen waste from the. So this was 10 years ago. So this is the first time we looked at this. And now, hold on and watch what happens here. These are some of the images from that project. So this is the wastewater treat. This is a sewage treatment process going on here outside of the living spaces and in the landscape. This is Blatchford, a much larger project for 14,000 people in Edmonton, Alberta. And these are the water treatment systems. There are five levels of water now with different levels of suspended solids in them. They're very much a part of nature. They're very much a part of the recreation in the winter. This freezes and skating in the summer. It's full of it's on a flyway, so it's full of birds, this is the diagram for the whole systems thinking about Blatchford. So you first of all have all your water systems, rainwater, storage on site, treatment on site, stormwater collection as part of a natural system. In terms of energy, we start with biomass. There's a lot of agriculture around, so a lot of biomass available to us, and we use it to heat a boiler, and we're creating electricity out of that heat, enough electricity for the entire development, but also we're exporting that electricity to a district energy loop that goes out and serves office buildings in the downtown core. We're going to have at the next stage true geothermal, deep geothermal. So there's a bit of a lava dome underneath Edmonton. And so learning from Iceland, we're getting free, endless free, carbon-free energy from it. And then there are waste cycles. The sewage waste is treated. Certain things are then going to the municipal system. So this really represents the project, and this really represents the city of Edmonton and all of the things that we're affecting as a result of our. So we're exchanging energy, water, waste with a larger community. So it's not just even the superlative performance of what we're doing, but it's the performance of we're improving the performance of the city around us. The net impact of this over 20 years is 3.2 million tons of carbon averted, over 20 years as a result of this development. Now that's a significant impact. At that point you really can say you're really making a difference as an architect. This is a diagram for a sustainable campus at a university, derived from a project that I can't show you that we did for Disney at Shanghai theme park that's just about to open, actually. We took a whole systems approach and designed all the systems at the Disney theme park in Shanghai. And of course, they've got much more complicated water systems. They've got five different levels of water. Of course, in Shanghai, everything's polluted, right? The rainwater's polluted, the groundwater's polluted. So Disney's concerned about infection and the impacts it has on its visitors. So they sought to make this the cleanest place in Shanghai, and they sought our advice in doing so. So we have all of these methods of cleaning naturally and stratifying water for different uses. Energy systems are also quite complex, biomass-driven, augmented by wind-driven towers out in the bay, providing heating and cooling at different times of the year, through a cogen, providing electricity, photovoltaic panels as part of the. The main source of energy there is human and food waste. There's a lot of human and food waste in a Disney theme park. So we put that in a biomass reactor, and we take energy off it. And it's not completely the campus is not completely powered by food waste, but it's about 70% food and human waste. We can gasify that. We can take gas and other things out of the sewage treatment plant to augment this. So at the end of the day, we're creating biodiesel, which is running all the little trains and things that are there. We're creating heat, electricity, cooling. We're treating all of our waste products, whether it's humoid food waste, garbage, sewage. It's a very integrated model and it's under construction. So think about those range of things, how they've exploded, how they've gotten more complex. But they're managed by me, an architect. You know, I'm the one who says, can we do this? Can we do this? I can't answer those questions, but I've surrounded myself in charrettes with engineers who can. And those engineers are part of the team. But think of all the things we impact now. We're affecting cities. We're affecting an enormous impact around. Next subject is regenerative design. It's the second last one I want to cover, so I won't be too much longer. And this is an image taken from Van Dusen Botanical Gardens of the green roof, and it's this idea that. If we're doing less bad to the environment, at some point you reach a point where you're doing no bad, and then regenerative design is part where you're actually contributing to the biosphere and nature in a positive way. And so there are five different roofs on Van Dusen, and they all have a purpose. These are natural nodding onions and grasses, and they support a butterfly colony that was extinct in the city and is no longer so as a result of this and another major building, the convention center, that has a similar attitude. I'm very interested in this idea of regenerating nature through what we design, and I think it's our responsibility. So these are this is a diagram of mine. This is environmental degradation, and this is what lead does. You know, as we get better from lead silver to platinum, we do less bad. You know, we minimize. At some point, you reach the point of sustainability when you're doing no bad. And the living building challenge, if you have ever heard of that, 19 criteria that you have to meet to fit that very aggressive sustainable design performance standard out of Seattle initially, but now global impact. Zero impact buildings, so zero net energy buildings, zero carbon buildings, and so on are in this area here. But what we're interested in is things that have a positive impact on the environment that we call regenerative, because it's affecting nature. And these are diagrams working with Ray Cole. We're trying to build a regenerative design standard. But really, it's about the interconnectedness of everything in the world. That's human buildings, human cities, human use of resources, and the ability of the global systems to provide those resources. It covers energy, land, water, and material. Land is really the society as well as land itself. and it covers cycles of use, recycling, restoration, and production. So we've come to know them that way. This is the first building that I designed where I actually faced ecological issues. This is in a place called Sudbury, Ontario, where they have a nickel mine and a vast pollution apparatus that's killed everything. At one point, this was a moonscape. Dr. John Gunn there, who's my client, is showing me how deep the soil used to be before the pollution killed every plant, and the acid rain washed all of the soil into the lakes, along with the heavy metals and pollutants, and killed all the fish in these acidified lakes. He has, of course, worked for years to convince INCO and now Vail to clean up their act, and so the landscape is returning. And he wanted to build a research lab at the edge of a lake that taught lessons about this story. This lab is full of ecologists. They deal with water systems, land systems, and the effect of pollution on them, ecological systems. And so he started by helping us to make a map of the university, showing the ecological systems that were there, and wondering how we could be part of those in the design of the building. And so this is the Vail Living with Lake Center, and I'll only highlight a few things about the design, but I'll highlight the things that we learned from them. The roof systems connect with the grid, so the blueberries, which grow naturally in acidic environments, can be enjoyed by the flora, by the fauna. So the critters climb up on the roof and eat. The acidic rain is deliberately directed over. This is a gabion wall with limestone blocks, and eventually we built limestone walls to correct the pH before it entered into the lake. So the building is fixing acid rain in its production. The concrete is made out of slag, permanently entubing industrial pollutants that would infect the environment. And here are the facts in operation. The rainwater has a pH of 5.6. At the base of the limestone wall, it's non-acidic. It's a base at nearly 8. It then goes through a bioswale. We catch all the runoff from the hill through a wetland and into the lake. So the physical aspects of the building are improving the habitat for the ecosystems in the building in the lakes. That to me was an eye-opening discovery. And ever since, I've involved ecologists in every project I've done. This is the Center for Interactive Research on Sustainability, which I showed you the sectional diagram before. This is opened 2 years ago, and it's a zero net energy, zero carbon, lives off the rainwater that falls on it, treats its own sewage. It's going to meet the Living Building Challenge when we get it certified. It's a four-story research lab and lecture hall. This is the sewage treatment plant. It's a solar aquatics treatment system, so it's powered by the sun. It's maintained and operated by students studying biology on the university. This is the stormwater outlet. These are bins of soil. This is a photograph taken when the building was open, and then deciduous vines would grow on this west elevation to provide natural shade. They will, of course, have an annual cycle of spring, summer, fall, and winter. In wintertime, they defoliate and allow passive solar gain into the building. This is the Van Dusen Botanical Gardens. I talked about the shapes before. I talked about the five different types of roof. It has solar hot water on it, displacing the use of carbons in this building and an adjacent building, leading to a net zero carbon, net zero energy performance. This is that Oculus that I described earlier that's powering the natural ventilation systems. The rainwater is directed to a new piece of vegetation that's native species, indigenous species that's brought back. Obviously, whole ecological systems have been restored through the collection of the rainwater and treatment of the rainwater as part of this building into the landscape This is the machine that drives the ventilation systems. This is a heat sink. It's thick aluminum to conduct heat. It's lined up with the altitude and azimuth of the sun coming through. So in the winter time, the sun is low, and it hits this yellowy white paint and reflects. So it doesn't generate much heat here. So the ventilation rates are slow. But in the summer, when the sun is high, it comes on this bluey-black paint and gets the heat sink really hot and drives ventilation rates of 5 times the amount of the winter flow. So we're using nature to provide intelligent mechanical systems. And there are many other examples. Here's the 5 different roofs supporting different ecological systems. This is just when it was planted, so they haven't grown up yet. That's the earth ramp that leads down to the ground so that the critters can come up on the roof. And we know it works because coyotes have been spotted up here feasting on something, I guess. So it's definitely working. This is another example. This is a different example, but it's one I love. 2010 in Tacoma in Washington. So this is a Center for Urban Waters I designed with the Seattle office of Perkins and Will. It's a high-performance building, and blah blah blah. But this is what we did. So we repaired a riprap area here, and this is the lunchtime picnic area, and the seals haul themselves out and they sun themselves on these rocks and in a way that they never did before. These are snags taken from the forest. This used to be an osprey nesting area. And we wondered if we brought the snags back, would they? Well, sure enough, they did come and they did build a nest on one of these trees, and osprey are back and healthy again. Interestingly, now when we look at these snags, there's an endangered bee species in the Pacific Northwest. They don't build hives, they burrow in dead wood. These trees are now festooned with these native bees. I think these examples are extraordinary and wonderful. This is a Blatchford, that Edmonton project I show you. So we're daylighting streams, taking stormwater routes and daylighting them, turning them into natural streams that feed the water treatment system. We have a biomass district energy system. We've got extensions of train lines into it. But interestingly, Edmonton is part of northern Alberta, where there's a lot of farms. So this is a whole collection of urban farms. They're going to be three farms, professional farmers on the site. And of course, there are plots for people to grow their own vegetables. But there are also community plots and several markets that are there as part of this extension of our interaction with nature. The last section deals with the future of cities, and it's the one that's very interesting to me at the moment about sustaining life at a much larger scale and the things that we're seeing. This is a photograph or an image from the city of Vancouver's Bartholomew Plan. Bartholomew was a famous planner from the 20s. And these are elementary schools. And this is a 10-minute walk. So he told the folks where to put the elementary schools based on the fact that everybody could walk to school in 1925. And today, if you look at, you can see the playgrounds. They're still there, these little white patches, gravel patches, throughout the city. And so at the same time as we were observing these things, we were designing a dense node of development on a new transit line. And we postulated that to the city and made a presentation to the city that we should put 4 million square feet of development here, including offices, retail, residential, daycare, library, fitness, and that they should do that at every transit stop, and the impact would be profound. Vancouver, the carbon consumption per person, per capita, is 5.4, largely because there are no freeways and there's no suburbia. It's like San Francisco itself. It's a city of villages. But in comparison to other cities, Toronto, noticeably twice as much carbon per capita. Keep in mind that that the biosphere has the ability to sustain a population. We think that the global population will peak at somewhere around 9 or 10 billion in around 2050, and the biosphere has the ability to service that population stably if they all consume or emit only 2.2 tons of carbon per year times 10 billion people. So we've got to reduce these numbers still significantly. There are cities in Europe, such as Oslo and Vienna, principally walking cities, that also have numbers south of 5.4. Obviously, places like Calgary and Houston, I could shame quite a few cities here quite easily. With automobile-based communities, have an extremely long way to go. So we propose that that zoning be changed in the city at around transit nodes, and that mixed-use nodes be developed for commercial retail to really encourage much more walking, much less vehicles, and transform the city. And we were able to show and we were able to prove that if the zoning was implemented by 2030. Vancouver would go from 5.5 tons per capita to around 3. We're looking at the same kind of issues in the Bay Area. Obviously, enormous automobile infrastructure as well as some transit infrastructure, but particularly in the South Bay Area, people in red drive to work, people in blue walk to work. Oakland and San Francisco, we need to change that. We need to, if we're expecting, the next 2 million people to come into the Bay Area, if the density and the transit systems are like San Francisco, the emissions will be 2.3 million tons per year, and the amount of land will be that much. If we go at Oakland densities, we'll use this much land, and we'll have 26 million tons of emissions from those new people. And if we go out to a suburban location, it's 33 million tons and that much land. Well, there isn't that much land around, so that's not going to happen. But this idea that transit systems and regional systems can affect carbon footprints is extremely important. And so here we have, and the city of Vancouver is adopting this strategy, and the Bay Area needs to. Mixed-use developments are the heart of this. This is a new project in Calgary, where we've got hotel, office, retail, residential, rental, and community facilities all on one parcel. This we're designing in our office in San Francisco at the current time. The demise of the control of the automobile over cities was foreshadowed, obviously, with the removal of the Embarcadero in 1986, and the creation of creation of all these great public spaces, these great interfaces along the water, the revitalization of the waterfront and the buildings along it. There is no visitor or no resident of San Francisco who doesn't visit and enjoy these spaces on a regular basis. And so it is. We proposed the same in Seattle. They're removing their West Side Freeway. They're unfortunately building a very expensive tunnel underneath, but we did this plan for them. We're involved in the removal of a freeway in Toronto at the present time, as well as one in Vancouver. So we participate. This is the after in Toronto. Transit corridor, walking, bicycling, just to change a change in the nature of this, but also a change in energy systems. I talked about district energy systems in one more complex project. All university systems, hospital systems, neighborhoods will develop new approaches to energy collection and distribution. This happens to be the cost of solar energy measured in PV over the last 10 years. dropping from about $10 a watt to a little over a dollar a watt now. Soon our buildings will be covered in PV. It'll be part of the glazing system, part of the skin, and our buildings will all be connected to each other, to purple pipe systems, to district energy systems, to energy generation and distribution systems that are there. The theme of resilience, resilience is very topical at the moment. This is obviously Katrina and Sandy taught us about the need for cities resilience in some ways. Water, wind, building codes have changed, but other disasters have taught us, and particular around the disruption of services. So this is a little competition entry that our office did, a resilient health clinic. So this is a pre-modular, pre-packaged thing that sits at the edge of a schoolyard or in a park, and when the earthquake comes, paramedics and doctors and nurses go to this place, open it up, and it operates in a self-sustaining way to dispense health care to those injured and those in need, using these complete systems that I have been talking about. The health issues in cities are paramount. People are changing. The fitness, the ability to ride bicycles, the ability to engage in the city with non-vehicular approaches, the parks, the fitness areas in parks. There's a dramatic change going on in cities at the moment, and in evidence in San Francisco. These are people growing their own vegetables. They're sharing vegetables with each other. There's going to be storage, so you can keep your potatoes and apples and so on, or you can share a surplus with others. So there's an idea that one of the systems that can be provided on the site is a food source. The future face of high performance design is of some interest to me, and I've traced a series of ideas here: social responsibility, corporate innovation, whole systems thinking, regenerative design, future cities. And they're kind of like running in parallel with our ability as architects to do things. You know, we started out in the same period of my career, hand drawing, CAD, 3D visualization, BIM, Equitech and other analytical tools, advanced modeling, Rhino, computational designs. So there's this incredible kind of interweaving of technology with the expansion of the things we need to think about, and we need to start thinking about buildings and communities as living organisms. Now, what do living organisms do? They sustain life. They take in moisture and sunlight, and they produce leaves and flowers and seeds, and they sustain life. So do buildings. They protect us from the elements. They keep us healthy as opposed to unhealthy. They can harvest energy. They can use energy. Can they adapt? Plants adapt over time, evolution and so on. We're thinking of resilience now and how our cities have to change and how our communities have to change, buildings have to change to deal with climate change, the raising of the oceans, the challenges of more extreme temperatures, more precipitation, and so on, and they prosper. Plants prosper. They seed themselves. They grow. They propagate. They expand their territory. They successfully. Well, our part in that is to ensure that all systems prosper. That we use regenerative design to encourage. All systems, not just ourselves, not just the human species, but all species need to prosper. And so these are the things we thought about at the Van Dusen Botanical Garden. It's deliberately organic in its nature. It is, again, modular, prefabricated, made out of wood, naturally ventilated, lives off the rainwater that falls on it, treats sewage. It actually generates more clean water than it falls on it, because all the visitors bring liquids with them and leave them here, and we treat them and put them on the plants. We take the compost from human remains, food remains, and add it as nutrients into the plant systems there. I've already talked about the roofs and the different species that are on it. So in my view, we can create architecture that allows all species and the biosphere to prosper for future generations. That's the end of my presentation. How am I doing time-wise?
Yikes.
Sorry.
Thank you very much. I'm wondering if there are any questions right now in the audience.
Hey, can you hear me? Hello.
So I know that installing these recycling systems in any building can be really costly and pretty complicated. Have you ever considered selling the bio waste and things like that and getting paid for it as opposed to bearing the cost of recycling it yourself and the cost of
human waste?
The fats or even the green waste that any particular building would produce.
Well, yes, and we do think, you know, I could have gone into much more detail about, you know, the even as far back as Dockside, the restaurant tenants were required to take their waste product and put it into the biomass generator, particularly the oils and biosolids that can be combusted and so on. Yes, absolutely. The answer is in terms of exporting them and selling them. So each community has a whole series of economic relationships to each other.
Yeah.
And if you can, at Dockside, again, we did sell the treated gray water to an adjacent factory that needed it and generate $60,000 a year in income that benefits the operation of the facility because of that water. So we do think about those things and try to incorporate them more in community design rather than individual buildings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So when you're designing it, you kind of weigh the difference or, I guess, the long-term, not consequences, but just a long-term strategy, should we sell or is it more cost-effective to install our own recycling?
We don't typically worry about cost. Mm-hmm. We don't typically worry about money. We worry about nature. We worry about human health. We worry about architectural design. And if the solution is to sell all those vegetables in the summer and buy them from California in winter, that's one kind of economic relationship, but we would hope that by showing them how things can be done, that they would set up things that are more sensible in doing it. We don't prescribe economic models for the tenants or owners of our buildings or projects. We just don't go there. You know, it's up to the marketplace to figure that one out. We'll set it up right. But good questions.
Any more of those?
Hi. So I came across this article that in China by the year 2025 or 2030, there won't be any clean water which a human being can use. So are there any techniques?
I think they're there already.
Okay.
No, they aren't. There's no water body in China that's not polluted beyond the ability to drink it as it is. There is
so
one.
As you said, like you are doing the plan for Disney to improve these conditions, is there any way like that China can, or any other countries which are going to face these problems really soon, can get over this and start to produce like, or have technologies in which they can have fresh water for use?
Well, I mean, the problem, let's take China, for example. The problem is massive, and it's cultural. You know, the garbage on the streets, the garbage in nature, the garbage in the water, it's astonishing that the environment has not, in their headlong rush to create economic wealth, to raise the majority of their population out of poverty, they forgot the environment. It was a place where you dumped foul air, dumped old oil, dumped the environmental. But to a certain extent, the new leader has issued some instructions and he and others have realized, I mean, the the economic bill they're paying right now for the cigarette industry that they own, the government owns. They've done the math and they go, wait a minute, we better stop making cigarettes because it's going to be very, very expensive to treat all these cancer patients. It goes from that to the polluted rivers and lakes and oceans, the overfishing, the destruction of the natural environment. This concentration on economic vitality only at the expense of the environment is no more on display anywhere in the world worse than it is in China. And I'm afraid Africa's next. And India, too. You know, I just spent some time in India, and you know, there the poverty is, it's 20 years behind China. And it's, you know, I hope they don't make all the same mistakes. The knowledge is there. The systems are there. The thinkers are there. But can it be adopted by a political culture as part of an economic regeneration? I would hope that the battle's been lost in China, but I would hope that in India and Africa they don't head down the same road. I hope.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
I guess this is in part a political question because Europe and America were there in the 1960s.
Yeah.
In terms of pollution, so and who are we to ask other countries to not have the right to?
Well, and that was China's point over the last 10 years. You know, why should we reduce our carbon until we're as wealthy as you are? But but there is a higher order, and that is the biosphere, and it's a compelling argument to everybody.
The knowledge now is different than in the 1960s, that's true. Yeah. So it's an interesting question. I have one question in regards to the role, and I think I hope I talk for the students, because it's really amazing to see your array from a small piece of industrial design to the large picture of cities and the expert knowledge that goes into projects like this. And I think for the students it might be interesting to hear what you, being able to work in this amazing array, as in where you see the role as an architect, often architect in this process, actually. I would be interested.
Well, what I tried to show was, you know, kind of what happened to me in my career, you know, how it started off with these small little projects and innovation, thinking, research, teaching, and involving other expertise, sharing knowledge with other experts, moving towards design charrettes where you know, ecological systems are considered and so on. And I imagine that will only continue, you know. And now there's a spectrum of practitioners. You know, there are certain firms that just do shopping malls, and there are other firms that just do 25,000 square foot houses for people who don't care anything about these types of things. But you have an option. You have an option. You get to decide where you want to work and what your values are. I guess, as some of you will read in the book, my first degree is in philosophy. So I studied moral and ethics. And I came away from that thinking, well, I could go on ahead and be a political philosopher and teach. Or I could position myself in society in a way in which I could actually live out some of those values that I came to understand from reading philosophy. And so I set my moral compass pretty clearly on day one. And it's brought me wealth, happiness, success. You know, it's if you're true to your goals, and I know there's a whole generation out there that has different values, and good values as far as I can see, except for they won't put down their phones. I've got 4 20-year-old children, so I speak with experience. You have good values. Stick with them. Don't sell out. Find a place where you're comfortable. Find, read, learn, explore. Commit to your own future and making a difference. We have to do it. We have to do it. That's a good place to end.
I want to just thank you.
One more last question.
Here we go.
You mentioned the difficulties of building in structural timber in California, and I just wanted to know if you had any suggestions for the CBC, and more importantly, us as students and young architects, what we can do to influence the CPC to go in the right direction there?
Well, we're trying to get, first of all, we're trying to find clients who want wood structures. And it's kind of a techie place down here, and there's not much wood used here. So we have to find those people, and then we have to find ways of doing structural wood, laminations, and other things. The science is there, the engineering is there. There are firms in all over Europe, as well as some in Canada, that can do this. There's even firms here. Tipping Mar has some expertise here. Arup obviously has some expertise. At the moment, the restrictions on the use of structural timber in buildings in California is quite limited. And as you know, the regulatory regime in California, how can I say this without offending anybody? you fill in the words. It is one of the most complex in anywhere I've been. You know, whether it's the city getting approvals or we're doing a hospital right now. There's this organization called OSHPOD, which is just a nightmare of a bureaucratic organization. I've never seen anything like it in 35 years. You know. So you've got extremes. But one day I'll find it. I'll find a way. I'll let you guys know. I'll find a way.
Quickly, maybe.
Yeah, hopefully. Anyway, thanks for a bunch of good questions. They're great.
I just want to thank you. I won't ask another question, but I will say that I really appreciate for the students who think so much about how spaces look and work and feel, that you were presenting both buildings, spaces, and as well as cities with these exquisite images, but everything you said was about how they perform. And I think that is such an incredibly important aspect of how we should be thinking and how we should be talking about our, whatever we're designing, whether it's the small pop-up medical center that's waiting for the catastrophe, or whether it's the new city. So I just hope that every student will really realize when we speak about our environment that we're designing, it should be about how it performs and how it benefits. And I just really appreciate that as a gift back to them tonight.
Thanks. So. Well, hopefully they also saw the idea of design through there. I mean, I weeded out all the ugly ones.
No, but no, I think that the visuals speak for themselves in many ways, but when we actually talk about it, we aren't talking always about the visual because we see that, so yes. Then how, you know, we're going deeper. So yes. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much, Peter, for the great lecture, for the four books, and for all the wisdom.
Thank you for coming.